You're listening to Oilers Nation Radio, presented by the Nation Network. Subscribe for free on iTunes, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts from.
Welcome in episode 280. 280 of Oilers Nation Radio. Tyler, Rick, Dan, Liam, Kennedy stopping by, filling in for Bag Milk today.
Hello.
Bag Milk went too hard on his birthday. That happens. We've all been there.
We have all been
there. We were all there this morning for a meeting that Bag Milk was supposed to chair.
I really have been Bag Milk today.
Did he not preemptively pull out of this though? Did he preemptively understand that he was going to have too much the night before?
Yep.
Smart, smart, smart.
Yeah. We all have those birthday nights.
Smart.
I remember my 20th birthday vaguely where I had to change shirts rather quickly and I threw it behind a toilet. And then came back and got it at the end of the night as my friend let me borrow his sweater for the evening.
Where were you?
Were you just sweating?
The roadhouse. The ranch roadhouse.
Roadhouse.
No, I was not sweaty. I wish I was just sweating.
A little vomity?
I went, hello, Miss Bartender. Can I have a drink? She said, yep. She turned around. I gave a little something to the countertop. And then it went on my shirt. And I turned around and I said, Reed, I need your sweater right now. And he took off his sweater. Gave it to me. I ran to the bathroom. I shoved my t-shirt behind the toilet. And I was good for the rest of the night.
I think on Friday, Reed should get the hot performer of the week. You know, you got to take it back a little retroactively, yes, but that was a hell of a move.
There is no, what is that called when the crime expires? There's no
statute limitations
on
it's the reverse. Yeah.
Hot, yeah, cold performers.
Retroactively.
He was quick to react and no questions asked. Sweater off right onto me and I was ready to go.
It's a good lad, as your good people friend. Would say,
He's
Liam.
A great friend.
Yeah. Would have been even better if he didn't have a shirt underneath it and he was just going tarps off. Like, ah, you don't have to go tarps off.
Probably no shirts. Nah.
That's a good friend.
Let's start the show with our oodle noodle delicious debate. I didn't know where I was going with that for a second. I was going to try working a fun joke about oodle noodle. Nothing came to the top of my head, but I am here to tell you that you can get a free Oilers Nation sticker at all Oodle Noodle locations in Edmonton. Visit one today, snag a sticker, have some tasty nudes. Why not?
Ooh.
Maybe a little butter chicken mac and cheese, Liam.
I just had some Oodle Noodle for lunch.
Leftover?
I had the pad thai and my girlfriend's leftovers. And I also had the combo box, I think it's called.
Yeah, it is. Mm-hmm.
It was amazing. Shout out Oodle Noodle.
What protein did you get that?
The combo box?
Mm-hmm. Beef, prawn,
chicken and shrimp.
Chicken. No, I like it. Good call.
The delicious debate today on the back of him being named the rookie of the month for the month of March and his first shutout of the season. Rick, I'll start with you.
Yes, please.
Does Stuart Skinner have a legitimate case for the Calder trophy?
Yes, he does. This team is not only that, but the team is also going to probably be one of the top three teams in the West.
And he is their number one goalie.
Yes. So, I just don't think any player has been able to run away with it. That is now a 3-2-4 type of guy situation. He has to be one. You cannot leave him out.
Yeah. When we started talking about this, I can't remember what episode it was, but,
I brought it up around Christmas time but
Frank, I think Frank had brought it up on a couple show weeks ago, and yeah. We started talking about it. Admittedly, when I heard Frank's reasoning, I balked at it, but because the award is supposed to be the most outstanding rookie mm-hmm. on the season, you start to feel like, maybe Skinner isn't necessarily even the most, you know, outstanding goalie, that kind of thing. But really when you look at the draft class of the rookies for this season, I don't know if you can point at any one player and say they were more outstanding for their team than Stuart Skinner. Again, I'm taking a little bit of liberty with the definition. Siri didn't like that I was taking a little bit of liberty with my definition as to what a rookie of the year is. But I think that when you look at it from that perspective, he is just the most outstanding rookie there is.
Liam, what do you think? Stu Skinner's Calder chances.
I think he's I think he should be in a run-in, and I think this kind of end to the season where the Oilers, the team itself, has progressed so well and getting close to winning a division. Like, how could you not have him as one? Like, I think as Rick said, they're going to be a top three team in the conference, and they're not going to have a rookie of the year candidate when he's their starting goaltender. Like, Jack Campbell has not been good this season, and Stuart Skinner has had to take on way more of the workload than he deserved.
Not good in the first part of the season. Yeah.
Incredible
against Anaheim. Majority of the time, Jack Campbell hasn't been the better.
What have you done for me lately? Oh, I got you a shutout, sir.
Okay,
we'll talk about that in a second. But Liam, remove that nice Oilers Nation gear lid on your hat. If you were a voter for the Calder Trophy, you lived in another city, and you were just unbiased, would you put Skinner ahead of Beniers on your ballot?
Yes.
He literally removed the hat from his head.
I did. I wasn't sure where we were going.
Active role.
He just wanted to see your flow.
Stuart Skinner is the most wins by a rookie goaltender this season with 25. Logan Thompson is second. And then save percentage, he is down. He's 12th, but most of the goalies ahead of him have played like one game. But ahead of starters is Logan Thompson. And then who's this guy from New Jersey? Schmid?
Kira Schmid.
Is Thompson eligible for the Calder as well?
Yeah.
Okay. But I think his thing is his injuries.
Injuries have kind of taken him out of it. And a lot of people are like, oh, Skinner played games the last couple of years. I mean, Beniers played like 8 games last year, 10 games last year too, right? Like it's the same argument. Kennedy, the mustache man for the Calder. Yes or no?
Yes. 100%.
Okay.
I think he's had to fill in some pretty big shoes, especially with coming in this season from like Mike Smith and stuff like that from last season. So I think he's done his job very well. I've had this conversation with multiple people even from the beginning of the season where kind of figured that Stu was going to take over the starting role, and he's just overshot that by a million miles. I think he deserves it. He deserves the praise, and he deserves to be in this running for the Calder for sure.
Yeah. His number, I mean, he got off to just that flying start for this team, and he flatlined a little bit around January, February, but as of late, I just mentioned it, rookie of the month.
He never really dipped though. You say flatline, so I plateaued, right? You don't really dip at that point.
Yeah.
I don't think he's really had a down. He's not had a great game here and there, but I don't think he's really dipped like you see rookies do from time to time.
No, like I don't think he's had like a truly quote unquote terrible stretch by any means.
He's had a bad stretch, really. Have you?
When you compare his numbers, so like from the start of the year till December 31st, he had a .917 save percentage and a .278 goals against average. That is very, very good. From that span until now, or from January 1st until now, it's been a .903 and a .300 GAA. So like, again, the back half of the year wasn't as dominant as the front half of the year, but I think the context of first year with this kind of a workload, being a rookie, having the pressure of knowing your backup is not going to be that guy for the team and you need to be the starter and carry that workload. I think with all that context, you look at it and go, it's actually impressive his numbers didn't crater.
What's his win-loss record?
Since Jan 1?
No, on the whole.
On the season as a whole? I will have that for you in 2 seconds here.
So I think win-loss record has to come into
25, 14, and 5.
See, and you take everything you've just said and put all that together, I think that's, without a player running away with it and nobody really being better than anybody else, that's definitely right in there with everybody else.
Because, I mean, you look at Matty Beniers, who is, and our friends at Betway have it this way, where...
And he was the All-Star, too, right? That has to be another check mark or whatever you want to call
it. Matty Beniers would have been an All-Star, too.
He got hurt.
But he wasn't strong enough to play that game.
Yes.
Matty Beniers on the season as a whole, 53 points in 74 games. Like, that is a good rookie season, but it's not, like, so exceptional that it gives him the Calder full stop.
Yep.
And him kind of similar in a way to Skinner, like, good first half of the year, 25 points in 35 games, and then his production just kind of flatlined. He's not a guy who, by any means, got better as the year went on. 25 points in his first 35 games, 28 in his final 40 games of the year. So, again, not like Beniers has ran away with this at all. And it is kind of funny. You think back through the Oilers years, right? Gretzky never won a Calder. Think about all the high-end talent. Nuge didn't get his Calder that year. Hall got hurt, didn't get his Calder. McDavid got hurt, didn't get his Calder. Drysdale didn't get his Calder. For it to be Stuart Skinner that gets it is actually like really cool.
It's a goaltender in an organization who has not been able to raise a goaltender from infancy till, you know, to this point. In how long? This is great.
Ever? Yeah, no, I think the other element to this as well, to the voters, is in the past, when we've seen Oiler players get the nod against them, it's the Panarins of the world from the East Coast.
He's 63 when he won.
It's the Landeskog of Colorado. We're talking about a guy in Beniers that's actually further west than McDavid, than Skinner. So there's no chance that the East bias can leech in there for that conversation as well.
Yeah, 100%.
Who do you think the three finalists should be then? Just out of curiosity.
Skinner, Beniers, and
Michelli.
Michelli's
had like a sneaky good year out in the desert.
I haven't really heard of that guy until we played him.
He has, I just pulled up the numbers here because I was curious before Tyler mentioned it, but Michelli, the first half of the season in 30 games, had 22 points. In the second half of the season, He led all rookies from January 1st onwards in 30 games with another 23.
Mason McTavish with 42 points in 76 games is impressive, but like Michelli's outproduced him in less games. Like it is really, really good.
And I don't think either one of those numbers are better than what you're looking at a goaltender leading his team right now to one of the top spots in the division in the conference.
I agree. I think it's an interesting year because I think we mentioned it, but there's no one really like just absolutely grabbing this thing and being like, this is mine and nobody's taking it. Like, it's an interesting class. I actually slightly disappointed at it. I think it could have been better. Mm-hmm. Like Beniers and McTavish have both been good. Kent Johnson's had a good second half of the year. YA Johnson's been good, but like, I feel like I wanted a little bit more from Owen Power, maybe as a guy like that. I just feel like that when that draft class came out, mm-hmm. there was a lot of hype behind it. And this was the year they were all coming in.
That draft class, were these all American players?
That was Jack Hughes's draft class.
This was not that big year when everybody came off their national team.
Right? That was the Broberg year when you had like the Caulfield and the Hughes and the
Zegras, Baldy.
Yeah. And then some of these guys came from Michigan then? Because Power came from Michigan.
This is like the Michigan year because it was Power, Beniers, Ken Johnson, and Hughes. What's his name? What's the brother called? Luke Hughes. Luke Hughes.
So they all played on the same Michigan team.
And lost to Carter Savoy from the University of Denver.
Nice. Good polio. Yeah, big smirk.
It all comes around to the Edmonton Oilers.
I think there's something to be said about having those super teams. That's why I didn't think all those guys coming off the U.S. national team. Mm-hmm. They all looked fantastic on their team, but I just felt like when you start to scatter amongst different players and different type of teammates and different roles, that they weren't all going to look as good as they were under the microscope at the time.
I mean, most of those guys have looked pretty good though.
They've looked okay. Yeah.
Hughes, elite. Zegras, elite. Boldy, elite. Caulfield, elite.
Caulfield can't stay healthy. Zegras, I think he still leaves me wanting more. I don't know why. Maybe just because he has such a an advertisable face and whatever that you expect more out of him. Boldy, I think he's been quietly good, but I don't think he's been like
he's been loudly good.
He's 99 points in his first 124 games. They just gave him like a $7-some million extension. He's legit. He's really, really good. He's one of the most underappreciated players in the league, in my opinion. And he's been like carrying that team offensively too.
Yeah. What did he do last night? Nothing.
Well,
they lost a third. Oh,
yeah.
The one guy from that program that really just hasn't worked out, which brings it back to LA, is Alex Turcotte.
Yeah. That's actually an interesting one. Yeah.
He's just the only one that had that high end potential. I'm just looking at this team. So this was the scoring from the year. It was Hughes, Caulfield, Zegras, Baldy, Cam York, who's a pretty good defenseman for Philly.
30 points in 80 games to start his career.
And Alex Turcotte. And that year, he had 62 points in 37 games and was sixth on the team in scoring.
And Caulfield wasn't having a huge, great, great offensive year this year, right?
He was having a good year.
And I'm not to say anything bad about him, but I mean, you get that sophomore jinx or whatever.
26 goals in 46 games. So if he stayed healthy, he would have popped 40.
All right.
Yeah. Anyways, interesting stuff with the Calder this year and Stuart Skinner. Shout out to our friends at Betway as well, who have Stuart Skinner. I believe it was plus 875 to win the Calder right now. You can check them out for everything, including tonight's game against the LA Kings, where I am locking in the under. I think it's going to be a low scoring game tonight. I think it's something about the way these two teams match up. They go so hard against each other that goals are tough to come by.
Then there's going to be that one game though.
They did hit the over in January.
I do think the Oilers are really working on keeping the puck out of their own net right now. Mm-hmm. And kind of like the last aspect of their game, they need to be ready to go for the playoffs. So I can see that being their focus.
A low scoring hockey tonight. Before we look ahead, I should say, to the playoff race and the game against LA, I want to look back to Saturday night. The night the Oilers clinched their spot in the Stanley Cup playoffs, and there was no one in that building, players included, more thrilled than Kennedy, who won. Clinching is a big day because it means we launched some new gear. We'll talk about that. But you got to see firsthand the show that Leon Draisaitl put up to get to 50 goals.
I'm still riding that high, and it's Tuesday. So, the walking into the building, because we did street team before, and people were already like electric, like, we're going to clinch. And then being in that, there was not an empty seat in that entire building.
Yeah.
It was incredible. So then, Leon scoring that first one. I was like, he's going to do it. He's going to do it. I think I tweeted it even before the game. I was like, he's going to get Leon 50 tonight. Sure enough.
playoff vibes now.
It is. Yeah.
Him, like Drysdale specifically, is hitting his stride right now. And I know we've talked about this on a few episodes, but like every part of his game seems to be rounding together at the right moment. And him going out for that game, being like, ah, three away from 50, I'll do it tonight. Why not?
You know what the biggest part of it is?
Though? Sure.
Health.
Mm-hmm. You think?
Yeah. I think everyone kept saying, you know what, he wasn't quite himself a couple, you know, maybe 4 weeks ago-ish. I think even he came out and said something about
when
he's feeling better or something like that. And we saw what happened last year. I mean, the dude was getting by on one leg somehow.
Yeah. He's a beast when he's hurt so that way people don't think that he's doing it like right or whatever. But yeah. I saw when the Germans were here, like he got rocked a few times sitting on the bench, just like in pain. And it was like, something's not right there. And he went on a little bit of a dip, but you don't tell because he's still putting up those points. He's still awesome.
There's no limping. There's no flinching by him.
Not at all.
You know, he gets off the ice and keeps that straight face. And
yeah,
but I think he goes in healthy. I think you're going to see a different version of him this year.
Yeah, I think so as well. Like, again, the numbers from last year's playoffs speak for themselves. And the run Drysdale's been on over the last couple of months is just absolutely incredible. Since February 1st, the guy has 21 goals in his last 27 games, 44 points as well. Dan, Drysdale took it up a gear on Saturday. Any other big takeaways for you, or was it just the show that 29 put on?
For me, I think it was the fact that the Oilers, you know, I think I went into even the LA game expecting them to lose at some point, and also just worried that they were going to let a team like Anaheim stay in the game just because they have been doing that recently against the San Jose's and the Arizonas of the world. But for me, the Oilers really just hunkered down and took over that game right at the end of the first period. They got a late goal, right? Yeah. Brain is a little fuzzy from that night. But then the second period, it was just like, there was only one team out on the ice at that point on. And it was clear, and you love to see it. The boys were able to get that shutout for Campbell as well. You could see that was something that Campbell made some really, you know, 10 bell saves there where he shouldn't have had to, but he was able to do that. And you could see the team was just kind of rallying around him. So I love to see it. I love to see that whole team effort, and they stomped on the Anaheim Ducks, which is something that they don't do often enough.
Yeah, they gave it to them. And I think with Jack Campbell, we kind of saw against Arizona, he made some big saves in the first period and then letting a couple of softies. And that's kind of been his downfall, I think, for honestly a lot of the year. Is that
he'll make the whole year big saves.
But then all of a sudden something trickles by him because his rebound isn't great. But on Saturday, it was exactly what you wanted from him. And hopefully this can just be something that is a momentum builder for him. I don't know how many more games he's going to play this season, probably two. And then if you need him in the playoffs, hopefully you don't need him in the playoffs. If you do something went wrong
tomorrow,
he'll play. Yeah. Tomorrow. And then I would guess one of the San Jose games too. Hopefully it's a building block for good old Jack.
Can we stop saying the name Picard now, please?
Who?
I was never on board with that. Just because, and again, I am not a Jack Campbell. I've not been one of the people who's like, oh, come on, give Jack a break. Like, that hasn't been my stance at all this year. But the people who are like, why not bring up Picard and see what you have in him? My take was, it's pointless. Like, again, Calvin Picard, maybe he'll be league average for you for a little bit. But like, if you need either one of Picard or Campbell in the playoffs, you are in a whole world of trouble. And I'd rather just try to give my $5 million guy something to bring into the offseason, a little morsel of positivity. And Saturday night was certainly that.
Goaltending is voodoo. Goaltenders are voodoo. I don't think it takes a lot to turn your game around there. It can just turn on a dime. And I think you saw it against the Arizona game that, you know, you got the vest out of it. I think there was some positivity came out of it. And then you saw it on Saturday, and you'll see it again. I'm praying you'll see more of it tomorrow.
Picard is a 908 in the AHL this season.
Yeah.
Like, so does Rodrigue.
It was cool though after the game to see Skinner kind of giving Campbell some love too, though.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
And it's great seeing this part of our game coming together five games before the playoffs start.
It just feels like there's such a unity on this team. And it obviously comes when you win games very often like the Oilers do, but it just feels like they're a very attached group at the moment. And
it's like a trust thing, right?
Yeah.
Like, you find that they're like almost trusting each other a little bit more. And you know, you put those pieces into place that like Holland got for playoffs.
Yeah.
And it's just all working out.
Yeah, Matthias Ekholm continues to be a beast. I like Nick Bjugstad way more than I thought I would like Nick Bjugstad as well. Just focusing on Campbell again for a second, there were some people who had really put their positivity pants back on with Soup. I had someone tweeting and commenting in the chat today. I forget who it was, but they're like, he's going to be next year. He'll be like Ullmark, where like he goes from, you know, being bad to being great. And I looked at Allmark's numbers. Linus Ullmark has never had a season below 900 in the NHL, even when he was on those dog shit Sabres teams for 4 or 5 years to start his career. And last year he had a 917 with Boston. So I don't think that comparison is necessarily there. Some people like to point out, you know, Jacob Markstrom struggled in his first year in Calgary. And sometimes these big ticket guys.
Pardon? And his third year.
And his third, yeah. First and third. But the second one, he was good. So some people holding on to that, hey, maybe that second year for Jack Campbell in Edmonton could be a little bit better. And I mean, I don't know. There's a lot of other things to get to before we talk about next year's Jack Campbell.
Yeah, let's not worry about that yet. Yeah. I think the Oilers are still going to go out and get a very good third string goalie this summer. I think you have to. You can't just bank on Jack Campbell's turning it around with no evidence that that's going to truly happen.
So do you go and replace Picard then?
I think he's only on a 1 year deal. I mean, depends what's out there, right? They clearly wanted a good third string goalie this year.
So you're going to go find another version of Picard. Cause I think Ollie is still.
Picard has one more year, Liam.
Oh, does he? Okay. Well,
yeah, I don't think you're getting a goalie
recipe then.
So I think you still have Ollie in the, whatever the train tracks of, you know, growing up into the NHL level. And I think you'll be fine letting him play the majority and have your veteran kind of be your 1B over there and your call up.
Well, I think it'll be interesting with Rodriguez actually this summer, because I think he's an RFA, right? You got that one now?
Rodriguez.
Just because Ryan Fanti is, how long are you going to keep him in the East Coast for? I know Skinner was kind of up and down a little bit. Maybe it's just an offseason conversation, but
Rodriguez is an RFA. Fanti has one more year. So
yeah. And then there's also, they drafted a goalie too. So it'll be interesting. Interesting in the crease. I didn't know Picard was one more year.
One more season. I mean, that's not like, he is a veteran guy. Like if you want to bring Fanti up because he's doing so well, Picard's not stopping you from doing that. But he has been great for Bakersfield this year. I know Holloway was on with Gregor earlier in the week or late last week and said, talked about how like the quality starts they've been getting from Picard has been a big reason why Bako's been able to kind of go on the run that they have gone on. He's also been back skating as well, getting into the mix.
Dylan, he's playing.
Yeah, sorry, that's what I meant by skating.
He's like got back in the mix.
Is that a guy, like when you look at this Oilers forward line up and the situation there, right now, when they go 12-6, Devin Shore gets the final spot. Mm-hmm. Ryan McLeod should be back on the ice before the end of the regular season because he said yesterday that he's about a week-ish away from his return. So when he comes back, you then go 12-6 and take Devin Shore out. If it came down to it, if Dylan Holloway's healthy, Holloway or Klim Kostin or Matthias Janmark, you got to scratch one. Who do you scratch, Rick?
I'm scratching Holloway right now. I just want the veteran, the vets in their own end. You got to be really worried about your own end at this point. I think I'm a little more confident in those two.
I'm scratching Klim Kostin at this point. I just think that Klim is not the player that he was at the start of the season. I think he needs to get back to, it's almost like a, it feels like a Cassian situation.
But you're going to play Holloway ahead of him.
Yep. Just because,
but forget, you have to put Holloway, who's more used to playing important minutes, certain minute levels and game situations. And you're going to be asking him to change his type of game and minutes. And we've seen that's very hard for some players.
Yeah, I agree. I think that Kostin is right now just needs some kind of a reset. And I would try and use that as an opportunity to do that.
When you say bench these guys, are we talking game one of the playoffs?
Game one of the playoffs. Okay. What would you do?
Because I think Janmark has to be in your lineup for game one.
Because of the penalty killing?
Yeah, and just his style of play is exactly what you want. He's that kind of guy that they went out and got Bjugstad for. Same idea.
I was going to say, you will get McLeod killing penalties again, right, too? So just if you were to take out that.
Yeah, that's true.
I think my vote would actually be for Janmark. I don't know. He's flatlined a little bit for me as well. And when I look at, you know, okay, what are the best attributes you have? I look at Janmark, he's steady and he's consistent. And there is value in having a guy like that in the lineup.
Yes.
Klim Kostin has a bit more offensive upside, in my opinion.
Yes.
He has the ability to drop the mitts, lay a big hit that gives you some energy. Dylan Holloway, speed to freaking burn. And again, offensive upside there. And if you look up and down this Oilers lineup, do you need the penalty killing? Like you said, McLeod's back killing. You know they're going to, in the playoffs, they'll have McDavid and Draisaitl killing penalties once in a while. Yamamoto kills penalties.
Are you worried at all about Holloway in the puck in his own end? Or coverage in his own end? Cause that's kind of where, that's where my
but you can
thought pick. Process was there the most. Yeah. I want the veterans. I know it's in 2023. You need to give the youth a chance and stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm still the guy who's going to give the vets at this point. And they're not even that even old. I mean, Austin's like 23, 24 and Yanmar's like 29. I just feel more comfortable having those guys. They've been playing all year. You know, they know what they've been there. I obviously Costin really hasn't, but that's just where my comfortability is right now. And if you do get an injury out in your top nine, then I might be going putting Holloway in there and giving him those types of minutes.
Liam and I both just yawned at the same time. Liam, you clearly don't have a take on Holloway.
Good show so far. I'm sticking with Holloway and Bakersfield, to be honest. I just think with Holloway, I think he needs to find consistency every single night. He didn't play a lot before he came to the Oilers. Like he had the injury, right? Whatever it was. I think with Janmark, he has the experience. He went to the cup final, I think, with Dallas, right? And he had that good run with Vegas a few years ago, too. It can add to that. And I think if, hypothetically, you play LA in the first round, I would like to have Klim Shady in there who could be the wheels of someone if you really needed that to happen. Holloway is just not going to happen. And I would just bring him up late, maybe later and just be around it.
So you're going to play him in the AHL? You're going to leave him down in Baco as opposed to being like a black ace or something like that?
I would let them play out their season. I like the sixth season. They'll likely be out in the first round anyway. Hopefully they go far, but that's what I would do. And then call up whoever you need after that.
Yeah. Build your black ace staff after that.
Especially if you're in LA anyway, right? So what does it really matter?
Yeah.
Or Vegas, it's both right there.
Yeah. Kennedy, would you play Dylan Holloway game one of the playoffs?
No, I agree with Liam saying that like the experience level isn't there. Like he's just, his speed and he's able to score and stuff, but I don't trust him enough to play him in game one. I'd rather the vets out there for sure.
And I could see that as well. I actually think that might be why if they go 11-7, Klim Costin comes out of the lineup. I think that's a guy who took some untimely penalties at a few points earlier in the year, a couple months ago. Feels like he's almost lost the trust of this coaching staff in a bit. When you look, I mean, his minutes are way down. There was a point where he had like legit top six looks at sometimes. And we were like, oh shit. Like
I think he was 8 or 9 minutes on Saturday, wasn't he?
Yeah, he did get a bit of a tick up on Saturday.
4:24 there, the LA game or something.
So what was the difference? A 2-0 game and a 6-0 game. He played a lot in the third against the Anaheim Ducks as well. So, but again, like I actually think that's on the coaching staff to get a guy going. We're at a point in the season here where the games are very big, yes, but the priority is making sure everyone is at 100% come game one. Whoever you play round one, game one, don't care. Everyone's got to be humming at 100%. 4 minutes in meaningful hockey games just isn't going to do that for
you're
a guy.
You're putting that above like the division race? Those are the two thought processes, right?
But I just think they can both exist. I think there's a middle ground between like...
I agree.
4 minutes for Costin. And, you know, I'm not saying give the guy 18 minutes a game.
No, because I mean, he was 4:24 that game. I think Derek Ryan was 6:50.
Yeah.
And then you had Broberg, who also like 4-something. So,
You're almost playing with three less players.
Also,
in a way.
Yeah. And I think there is something to be said about when those guys are down at 4, 5, 6, where McDavid, Draisaitl and the big guns at? Let's keep them a little fresh.
I think it was the secondary guys or they wasn't the top end guys that got those extra minutes. I think it was like the
third line,
the level above the Costin and the Ryan, if you will.
Yeah.
What game was that one?
LA
on Thursday. I got to go back a month.
Oh no.
Back a month.
It's going to take us a while.
He's getting over here.
Okay, loading.
Lousy smart.
Loading.
It's great.
Yawning.
You know what we could do, Liam? Is while you're doing that, you're going on a bit of an adventure now.
You've just done an adventure.
Yeah. Our friends at AMA Travel, they can help you with whatever kind of adventure you want. Maybe not this specific one. I'm talking more of a travel adventure, whether you're staying local in Alberta or if you're heading out abroad, AMA Travel can help you with whatever you need. AMATravel.ca. All right, Liam, now you got the stat.
Leon Draisaitl played almost 24 minutes.
Hi.
McDavid played 21-25. Nuge was around 20. Kane was around 20. Yamo 17.
Right.
Yeah, there was so of that 23 minutes, 3.5 were on the power play. Mm. So that's the thing. Like a lot of these guys, minutes are coming out like McDavid, 3.5 on the power play. Nuge, 3 minutes on the power play. Hyman, 3.5. He played 20 minutes. But yeah, like the minutes were actually fairly balanced. Like Nick Bjugstad outside of the bottom line of Costin and Derek Ryan. Fogel played 12:52. That was the third lowest ice time.
Yeah.
So it's interesting.
Well, I mean, that's a team, that's a game against a team that you're going to likely see in a round of the playoffs. Also, you're competing with them for position right now. So,
all I would ask is though, why would you play 11-7? If you're the home team, and I get it against them on the road, like I wouldn't be surprised if they do it tonight to get McDavid and Draisaitl away from Deneau and Kopitar as much as you can. But why at home? You have the change, you have the advantage. Why not just, if you're going to play Philip Broberg 4 minutes a night, what's the point? So he can watch the game.
I don't think you go into
spot.
The game expecting to play in 4 minutes, but as the game progresses, you know, Manson's tapping somebody, and just, you know, you start to realize, well, 86 isn't really getting tapped all that often, but well, there's, we'd rather have him or him or him or him or him or out there instead.
But when you have three players in the middle of your bench collecting dust, essentially, because they haven't moved for 54 minutes, like, it's just kind of odd. Like, I feel like you do have a somewhat of an idea of being like, all right, if we get into this point, you should know you're going to have a tight matchup against the LA Kings. You know what I'm trying to say? So I'm just curious what the...
And the home change.
The home change.
There should have been some more opportunities to get those two go out, though.
I wonder if it's a little bit of gamesmanship from just like the whole, you're going to, if you think that you're going to see them in 2 weeks' time,
maybe
when you're at home, you do want to go back to that 12-6 and they don't want them expecting it.
You don't want to see what you're going to do game one of the playoffs.
Yeah.
Hide your hand a little bit.
I just, there's a thought there. I don't know if that's the answer.
Also, there's probably some of that in there. Yeah.
Sometimes I feel like we're looking at 11-7, 12-6 a little bit, maybe not quite the right way. Like, you could also go 12-6 and have, you know, Klim Kostin and Matthias Janmark split a spot, right? And you're almost going 11-6 in a weird way like that, which again, if you're going to start doing that, I just think I'd rather have the extra D-man on my bench. If someone blocks a shot and goes down, you're not running five D-man the rest of the game.
OT versus or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually,
that's a great point too. In playoffs, like, giddy up. What happens if you're going to play a 2-0 game? But remember,
the Anaheim series.
I'm not ready for that yet, man. Well, hold on a second. I know. Bag for a second.
Remember that Edmonton Winnipeg series where they went OT game? And like, granted, Dave Tippett, different coach, but like, he ran 4D in those overtimes. It was like a 3-0 game. He was running 4D the whole time. Yes. So maybe we are thinking too much about that.
Can in the stands.
Cause that was the game that Ethan Baird didn't play for like most of overtime came on and he scored and everyone blamed on him and it was just not his fault at all. Good times.
That was Nurse's kid was born that night.
Oh, what an evening. I had an MRI scan that night, I believe too.
How'd it go?
All good. I'm still here.
I died that night, actually. Rick. As a matter of fact, I was gone.
All right. We got some other stuff that we need to get to, but first we're going to step aside for a quick ad.
Good ad.
Liam, thank you for your review of that ad. All right. The Oilers clinched on Saturday night, and that means it is playoff time in Edmonton. Kennedy, our resident creative genius, has the new merch up at nationgear.ca. Hashtag ON Oil up. These are some of my favorite shirts that we've done in a while. Super unique. I love the oil drip. Kennedy, take us through the design.
We had a brainstorming session and I was getting everybody's ideas on like kind of what they're envisioning and what we wanted. We started with a hashtag and then ON Oil Up kind of came up, or Oil Up started. And then I kind of have an idea and wanted to make sure that it was like homegrown. You wanted the skyline in there. You wanted to make sure that it was Edmonton to its core, and played with the colors and decided, you know what, let's do two shirts. So they're up on nationgear.ca. We're going for it. This is the year. So,
and
Kennedy, I'm glad you mentioned the skyline or whatever, because I don't think you really honestly see it unless you're actually kind of sort of looking for it.
Yeah. Exactly.
And I was going to say, people can go and check Kennedy's Instagram, Kennedy's Trash, to be able to see all of the creative stuff, which I love.
Yes, I did a little insight into my brain of all the details and all that. That's on my Instagram. So check that out. But like, I'm super proud of this design. I hope a lot of other people like it too. I'm excited to rally around it. And then once we get our playoff parties going, this will be the brand of it all. And
we'll be supplying oil to everybody at our parties to oil up.
Fuel up, that's for sure. So it's
already hungover.
Playoffs is going to be exciting. Yeah, you can get your shirt nationgear.ca. Also, actually, I want to get to this first because there's black and blue and there is orange and white. Liam, which one do you like more?
Black and blue.
Dan?
I'm an orange and white guy.
I'm orange and white as well. Rick?
Black and blue.
That's surprising coming from you.
Yeah,
you like white everything.
Well, they're not.
So Kennedy,
there's another shirt out there that I'm a really big fan of. That's the white one.
I like that one too.
Pick your favorite child.
I really fought for the black and blue.
I am white and orange. I can't wait to get my hands on one, by the way.
Soon.
Wow, getting choked up about it.
But also, everything. I was told I've talked to you about this. I would like a custom order.
Okay.
Can you print it on a hoodie for me, a white hoodie?
I might be able to do something like this.
Wow. Wow, that was awesome. Okay, if anybody else would like to ask for custom orders, send that to rick@oilersnation.com.
Nope, I'm the only one that gets it. I want to be able to
stand up. I was going
to
say this, though. For playoff times, you get a little excited. Mm-hmm. If you've seen me, I can get a little animated. A black shirt goes further for me than a white shirt.
It's a good point.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We've seen the video.
I love a custom black one then, please.
Thank you. Also, Leon Draisaitl hit his 50th goal of the season, which means we got to drop another Leon Draisaitl effing phenomenality.
Yeah.
This one's cool. I like the little nod.
The bank for so long.
The whole season.
I know.
The whole damn season we've been sitting on this one.
Yeah. So I'm so glad that this one's finally out there. So cop it at nationgear.ca. This one's fun. German flag. Can't go wrong.
Yeah. I'd imagine this one's going to be a hit with our Oilers Nation DE friends as well. Yeah. They'll like this one.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. It's got the white t-shirt, which is, this is what you were hinting at.
Now I'm feeling it.
Yeah. The white t-shirt and then the German colors on there as well. Super unique look. Nationgear.ca is where you can get geared up and hashtag ON oil up for the playoff run, which gets
also going. Maybe keep your eyes there in case there's something else coming here. Maybe in a little bit.
Oh, is another Oilers player close to hitting a milestone for the year?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Second we're milestone. Keeping him forever. So
there you go. I like that, Kennedy. All right, let's get back into the hockey talk. We had this question floated to us as a part of our Monday mailbag up at Oilers Nation, but I wanted to get your guys' thoughts on it. Right now, the Edmonton Oilers, like I said, one of the hottest teams in the NHL. From January 1st onwards, they actually have the best points percentage in the Western Conference. LA, Vegas also up near the top in that race as well. But when you look at the Western Conference as a whole, not just the Pacific Division, who is the biggest threat to the Oilers going to the Stanley Cup final, Rick?
Colorado Avalanche.
You still think it's the Avs?
I do.
Even though five other teams in this conference have already clinched and they have not.
Yeah, that's okay. They took a weird route there, but as my friend Ric Flair says, in order to be the man, you must beat the man.
Okay.
So many sayings. I thought you were going to go a different direction.
Well, I don't know if I can. You got to be really on top of it for some of his poems.
Styling and profiling.
Yeah.
Dan, biggest threat in the West outside of the Oilers the Oilers?
I would probably agree with Rick, but if I'm going to not be boring and put Liam to sleep, I will say the Winnipeg Jets again, just because that's a team that it feels like what Calgary was to us last year, but they just have Connor Hellebuck. And if you had to play a Connor Hellebuck in a 4-game series and beat him 4 times or 7-game series and beat him 4 times, I just don't like our chances because that guy is so maddeningly good at what he does. So I would still agree with Rick.
We owe him
until we beat Colorado.
We owe him.
We owe him.
Yeah. So if he gets to face us, we owe him a couple extra goals.
Oh, 100%.
And there's still that one stop on Nurse in front of the net. This one timer that I still can't know. Don't know this.
So my answer would just be anybody that has like an all-star goalie, but Hellebuck would be my answer, I guess.
Kennedy.
Honestly, I'm terrified of LA. Yeah. I just have trauma from last year and just playing them every time feels like a playoff game, no matter what time of the season it is. So
Jay Woodcroft. Sorry. Todd McClellan.
And that's like, there's that. And then I don't know. They're rough. They get in your face.
Annoying.
And
you want to punch Daniel in the face. Really,
like, it took us 7 games to do it. It was nerve wracking.
Exactly. It was terrible.
Did we score an empty netter in that game?
Which one?
Game 7?
No.
Because it was 2-0, right?
McDavid scored.
It was Tyson Barrie.
Yeah. I can barely remember yesterday.
McDavid scored. They wrapped it around on Sean Durzi and they skated down the ice with both his fist shaking. And it was epic. I was there.
Oh, you're talking about this past
game 7.
Game 7. Isn't that what we're talking about?
Because a 2-0 game in game 7 is you're biting your fingernail the whole damn time.
Yeah. That was nerve wracking.
Yeah.
It was just thanks to beating the Flames in the next round that we forgot all about.
That was
a walk in the park.
Yeah. You know what? I want to address a take here. Actually, Liam, I'll let you give your answer first.
It's not the Winnipeg Jets. Honestly,
it's not the Jets either.
Hellebuck, what's his name?
Hellebuck.
Sorry, he's just irrelevant to me at the moment because they're not even going to make the playoffs. I don't think they don't worry me. I think it's the LA Kings just because they feel like they're just so built to try and beat the Oilers and it drives me nuts. And there's just all that rivalry there. And maybe if it just goes a physical way, the Oilers,
it's so maybe fresh. That goes
LA. Yeah. So I'll say them. And honestly, I feel like the Minnesota Wild eventually have got to kind of get over the hump. I feel like they've just been a really good team for a while. So if the Oilers make the Western Finals and it's Minnesota, then I think that'll be a difficult one for them.
So you say you don't think Winnipeg makes it. Do you think Calgary makes the playoffs then?
I kind of do. I don't know. I don't really have a reason. It's just kind of something I've thought about. Like Winnipeg has been on such a downward spiral.
How mad would you be if you're a Jets fan and Calgary makes the playoffs who has 7 wins less than you?
Yeah. My prediction at the start of the year was that 5 Pacific Division teams would make the playoffs. So
they play each other tonight.
The Calgary Flames have lost 5 more games than they've won this year. Straight up.
Flukiest team in the NHL.
Loser points.
What do you mean?
They have OTLs. 36 wins and 41 losses.
OTLs.
Oh, right. Sorry. I was looking at it. They have 26 losses. Yeah.
Yeah, no. I mean, granted.
That's what I looked at first too. I was like, I got to know.
The Jets have also lost more than they've won this year. The Jets are 43 and 34. And 34. Yeah. So they're 9 games above the, I call it the real
Nashville,
500 mark.
Nashville's technically 500, 38
yeah.
and 38.
Yeah.
In fact, Calgary's in this spot. Is it good luck? Or is it bad luck? It was a good luck to get that OTL, or was it bad luck they couldn't get 2?
I think eventually it becomes good luck, but to start with, it's bad luck. But then you start getting them towards the end of the day, you're like, all right, we got a point. Well, it's better than nothing.
Yeah. So my answer to the first question, like I am definitely probably the most worried about LA because we'd have to face them the earliest. Dallas actually does kind of scare me because that's a mobile blue line who could potentially be a problem for the Oilers and Jake Oettinger. Legit, but they don't have the high end skill like outside of Jason Robertson and Miro Heiskanen to compete with the Oilers. Colorado, it's like, okay, if they're healthy, Makar Rantanen, McKinnon, Landeskog potentially being back. Like that's some skill there. They're not as good as they were last year, but that is still a lot of skill. So the West is much better than I think some pundits out East want to give it credit for. The Pacific specifically.
Well, I think the East just took a lot of the spotlight looked at the West.
It took a lot of trade deadline fodder.
Yeah, good. And what has it done for them? Mm-hmm.
But here's a take I want to throw your way. And I think it was me and you talking about this the other day, Rick. I think a lot of people sitting here going, I want Calgary to make it because I want the Battle of Alberta again. I don't. We got them. And I don't know if this is a coward's take or not.
It's not.
But like, why do we want that rematch? We have bragging rights. We are the better team. I'm confident the Oilers would beat them in another best of 7. But like, there are Oilers fans out there who are like, I want the Battle of Alberta again so bad. And I'm like, yo.
Back of the line.
Yeah.
Earn your way back up here. This is not an automatic rematch. This is not the WWE championship.
You know, they would take a small victory out of like losing to us 4-2 instead of 4-1.
Yeah.
Right. Like you can't
victory out of us losing to Colorado. Yeah.
You can't defeat that kind of mentality. It's hard to win.
For them to sit there and have a decade of darkness.
I love that they're in the mix. I love that they're on the fringe and that they're hurts more. Yeah, exactly. It's going to sting a little bit more if it happens.
Calgary to like sneak in right now would just hurt more than beating them in a playoff round. But I do enjoy the chaos of a Battle of Alberta playoff series because that was mental. So
you'd stomp them.
Oh yeah.
See, and this is what everyone's like. We look at this team, that team, and the other team. Ekholm. Adding Ekholm changes so much. The way Darnell's playing right now.
The Oilers are better than they were last year.
They are.
The Flames are not.
Better.
No.
Colorado's not better. LA might be a little bit better because they're a little more healthy.
And they got Fiala. And their goaltending's better. LA's better.
Vegas is not better.
No.
Seattle might be better, but it's still insignificant.
Irrelevant.
Yeah. Vegas, or then Dallas is Dallas. Minnesota... After last night and the night before and their last game, their last 2 games, Minnesota, they shouldn't even be allowed in the playoffs anymore.
Minnesota forgets their like team identity the minute the playoffs start too. They change how they play.
Dude, their team identity is supposed to be this defensive structure. Yep. They gave them a goal of 30 seconds to go.
Yep.
And then their overtime was terrible. That was boring, boring, boring hockey. And I was already angry. Yeah.
Fair enough.
And it took a lot of money in my damn pocket.
Allegedly.
That was me betting on the Jays last night. Jeez. Shout out to Betway, 19 plus. Please play responsibly.
I could have cashed out my Oiler division win last night, $100 down. I could have got it at 195.
Ah.
Today is 102. I'm not taking my $2.
No.
Oh, we're gonna let this thing ride.
You also get your original 100 back. But if tonight goes their way,
sold it for 102. So it wouldn't be 202. I'd win $2.
Yeah, yeah. But it, like,
I get my $100 back for
whatever. And you could roll it fair. And just throw it on the Oilers.
Sure. No, I get you.
That is it. That's interesting. I wonder what it could be tonight, because Edmonton plays LA. If they win, they're now a point clear of LA. Same number of games changing played.
Yeah.
And Vegas, second of back-to-backs, playing a Nashville team that's pesky and has a lot to play for. Vegas on the second of back-to-backs. Nashville's got Saros going. It's quick for Vegas. Yeah, maybe tonight's a little last-second swingaroo here for the Oilers.
Call up some of our friends there, and Adam Larson and Mr. Eberle, for those last two games of the year.
Yeah.
Could you guys not please help us out a little bit? Help out me a little bit? I mean, maybe a little back and forth here from before.
Why not? They're 4 points back of Vegas right now, same number of games played. So it will be a tough road, but Vegas, as we outlined before, has a pretty tough schedule, and the Oilers are red hot. 9-0-1 in their last 10 games. They have won 4 in a row, and that is a nice time to roll into a big game against the LA Kings. 8:30 start tonight. I know that fires you up, Rick. You're happy about it.
I'm ready to go.
Yeah. 8:30 start, Kennedy.
I'm already yawning, but I'm staying and watching. I'm watching.
Oh yeah.
This is playoff times. They can make it a 9:45 start. I don't care.
I would care.
I would care a little.
Well, I'm just excited for the post game show today with me and Zach.
2 a.m.
I think that's when it starts. Yeah. Ends at 5.
Very good. We pull an NHL. It'll start at 2:05.
Yeah. We'll start at 2:07 a.m. Yeah.
Guys, I regret to inform you, it's time for word association.
Yes. Yes. The big guy is smoking hot.
Wrapping up episode 280 of Oilers Nation Radio, presented by Oodle Noodle, with a little word association. I got 4 for you. 1 a little bit out there, and then 3 that are playoff themed. We will go Liam and then around the room. So Kennedy, right, since you're the guest today, you have the most time to think about it.
Thank you.
Number 1. The Oilers year-end team photo.
Disastrous.
Adorable?
No.
Regular.
Confusing.
Average.
Can I ask why it's confusing or disastrous?
Yeah, there's so many errors with it.
Tall players were short players.
I know exactly what you're going to say. You're going to say Ken Holland's tie
wasn't straight.
I agree there.
Woodcroft's blazer was like not over. Also, I thought the goalies were in a weird spot. I know I usually sit on the end, but they're so far away from the team. Yamamoto's in the middle. You can barely see him. Vincent Dayonnet's on the end. So it goes like straight line, Vinny back down. What's his name?
Bouchard?
No, the other B.
Bukestad
is on the other side. He's like 6'10".
I think Connor's not even looking.
He has a real big issue with this. I thought you were going to pull something out of your head here. He's got a whole scroll here.
This is going to be, if the Oilers win the Stanley Cup this year, this is going to be the picture that is in history.
Well, no, the one of them with the cup on the ice.
Sure, but there's also, there'll be like, that is the picture of like people talking about this is
the Hall of Fame or whatever.
This is the winning Edmonton Oilers team. And I'm just going to sit there with my red marker and circle all the errors. Yeah, it drives me nuts.
I thought it was adorable, and I thought the content that came out of it was adorable.
I like the Oilers, like the little speech McDavid gave behind the scenes and all that.
Did you not see some of the pictures yesterday from like previous, when the Oilers did like a team photo on the boat at West Edmonton Mall, and they're all dressed up like Peter Pan characters and stuff?
When?
What?
Oh, this is like Gretzky, Messier.
No, I've never seen that one.
Yeah, it's a while ago, but that's what I like to see. Cause even on Time to the Remember, the second movie they had, they were doing their team photo and they had like Pope hats and all sorts of weird, they had some fun with it. I like seeing some of that fun.
I'm all about the fun, Rick, you know me.
That is something. Pirates of the Coliseum. You need to put that in our group chat.
This is gold.
Let's see. Let's see this. Oh, wow. Incredible.
We'll make sure this makes the rounds on socials today so everyone listening can get a peek.
Good find, Rick.
That.
It's well, it's on Gregor's.
But Gregor tweeted it.
Okay. No, someone else tweeted it to him, but yes.
Good find.
All right. 3 more for word association. These are all playoff themed. Liam, you ready?
I'm ready.
What jerseys should the Oilers wear in the playoffs?
Blue.
Royal blue.
Royal blue and white.
Royal blue.
Royal blue.
All right. It is a sweep. OEG, listen up. ON playoff parties.
Epic.
You use that word a lot.
Unreal.
Hangovers.
Fuzzy.
Rager.
One word to sum up playoff time in Edmonton.
Undescribable. Indescribable.
Different.
Stanley Cup.
Together.
Stanley Cup's not one word.
I said together.
Sleepless.
Sleepless. Sleepless in YEG.
What a movie.
Why not?
That's only if you consider not. That's only if you consider passing out, not to be sleeping.
Oh,
that's a great point as well.
Thank you.
That's a great point as well. You've heard it for Masters Week. This is totally not
this
hockey related.
This is great. I can't
it's
wait.
It's a great sports week.
Thursday I have off, so I get to sit down and watch that.
Yeah.
No Oiler game that night though, I think, right?
No, they play
Tuesday, Wednesday, Saturday.
Today.
Saturday day game too, yeah, again.
2 o'clock, right in the middle of the Masters.
Big UFC fight though on Saturday, which will be fun.
Yeah. Then we have, golf all weekend, an Oiler game, whatever happens Saturday night. Yeah, be fun.
It's going to be, it's a fun time right now. This and October, two best times on the sports calendar.
We were talking about this before.
What are you thinking for the Masters?
I haven't done my research yet, so I won't give advice.
All right.
I do kind of like Corey Connors though.
That's good advice.
That is good advice.
Also, we're getting closer to patio season.
I know it's a little cloudy
right now, but it's nice outside. It's relatively sunny. It's spring. Everybody has more energy right now.
Yeah. The urge after a long winter of when you're driving home and the sun's shining, maybe you got a sunroof open like I do on the Nation truck. Shout out to Stuart for the Giant. And like the urge when it's like 3:30, you're driving home, you're like, I need to find a patio right now.
I drove by yesterday just to check the driving range over at Victoria. Still snow covered, bit of a downer, but hey, we'll see what happens in like another 7 days.
One by my house in St. Albert, they just, they get a little thing to come and clean it off. It's been,
well, they might do that. They might do that, but they haven't done it yet.
Millwoods Golf Course just opened their driving range.
Hell yeah.
Oof.
This need to get there. They supposed have the, to be nice. It's supposed to be like,
they have the sand like trap there. I can go practice. Yeah.
Ooh.
Oh, that was all the snow gone.
Scotty Scheffler is the favorite this weekend.
Off.
He is at Augusta.
That way. And then it's Rory, Rahm, Spieth, Cantley.
Patrick Cantley, yeah.
And then Cameron Smith.
Hats off to them for putting some foursomes together, some pairs that are a little LIV and a little PGA and a little dramatic maybe here.
Yeah, it's going to be a really good weekend for golf.
Are Rory McIlroy and Patrick Reed together?
I don't think so. I saw Duthie.
That would be special. Aren't they suing each other?
There is a lot of legal stuff going on. Yes. Woods, Hovland, Shoffley, Thomas, Rahm, and Young. So yeah. Interesting groups. Fun. Yeah. Going to be a good week. Hopefully the Oilers walk out of it with some points. Hopefully they get back in the mix for the top spot in the division. Go Six Oilers, points. Go Preds.
6 points.
6 points. 6 points.
Six two tonight, points. Two tomorrow, two Saturday, six.
Shutout streak alive tonight. Here's a question. Did the Oilers, knock on wood, get out of the first period with that streak alive?
Tonight?
Yeah.
Yes.
I think they will. I think it'll be a low scoring affair.
Do the Oilers make it three in a row then?
Yes.
I
may as well.
I'll say that's a tough one.
No. Well,
it's a big ask.
I'm superstitious for this.
It's a big ask to ask them to get one.
Yeah.
I said shutout when they against Anaheim.
It was brought up a couple times that night, actually.
Spencer said that night and he was like, we're doing street team. I was like, zip it.
No,
it worked.
Just gotta say it.
Yeah, when people like drop it without even realizing they're dropping, like, do you not know who I am? I mean, like, I take this shit seriously.
I'm like, be cool.
Get the hell away from me.
Yeah.
Oilers Kings 8:30 as we head down the stretch. Don't forget, you can subscribe to our YouTube channel for shows like Oilers Nation After Dark, which will be live right after the hockey game. You can find content and video content from this podcast there as well. Owen Everyday, Real Life, all that good stuff. Go subscribe to Oilers Nation on YouTube because we have rebranded. It used to be the Nation Network. Now it's just Oilers Nation. So it is nothing but Oilers content down the stretch. So there you go. Giddy up, Oilers fans. Enjoy this week. Enjoy the great weather if you're in Edmonton, and we will chat again on Friday.